Welcome, Age of Vintage Society. For a time in the 1930s, Jean Harlow was the biggest star in Hollywood. Her vampy good looks, easy glamour, and natural sex appeal earned her the nickname the Blonde Bombshell. But underneath her polished facade was a tender soul too often abused by studios and racked with heartache, all the way until her devastating end. Was the death of Jean Harlow's husband masked by the studio fixers? Make sure to watch the video until the end and leave your thoughts in the comments. If you are new here, join our wonderful community by subscribing to the Age of Vintage channel. Jean Harlow, Hollywood's original blonde bombshell. The tangled tale of Jean Harlow, her dead husband and his secret wife. Though she was America's blonde bombshell, in many ways movie star Jean Harlow led a less than glamorous life. Jean Harlow got a reputation as a bit of a gangster's mole. She dated mobster Abner Zwillman and was even an informal godmother to the daughter of infamous gangster Bugsy Siegel. Critic and writer Graham Greene once even crudely commented on her acting. Her technique was a gangster's technique. She toted a breast like a man totes a gun. Jean Harlow made her mark on Hollywood and the world, leaving behind a new image of the Hollywood sex goddess. She achieved a great deal of success during her lifetime. In an acting career that lasted 10 short years, Jean made 36 movies. Some of her other achievements included being voted number 22 on the American Film Institute's list of the greatest American screen legends. She came from Midwestern roots, having been born Harlene Harlow Carpenter in Kansas City, Missouri in 1911. Her father, a dentist, and her mother, a homemaker, had an unhappy marriage and divorced when Harlene was 11 years old. An only child, Harlene was indulged by her overprotective mother, who pushed Harlene into show business after the elder woman failed to make her own mark in Hollywood. Harlene was an amalgam of her mother's maiden name, Jean Harlow, which the actress later took as her stage name. At the age of 16, she eloped with Charles McGrew, a young bond broker. Their marriage ended after she decided to pursue an acting career against the will of her husband. Harlene started with bit parts, then signed a contract with director Hal Roach, who cast Harlow as a swanky blonde in a Laurel and Hardy short. Harlow next signed a contract with director Howard Hughes, who featured her as a vamp in the 1930 film Hell's Angels. She later appeared alongside James Cagney in director William A. Wellman's The Public Enemy, which became one of the top box office draws of 1931. Jean became even more successful and loved, not least because of her first 1933 flick, Hold Your Man. The movie Red Dust, in which blonde bombshell had bathed in a rain barrel while Clark Gable played with her hair, had the moral minority frothing at the mouth. Just try to imagine the atmosphere then when her husband died during its making, and some reckoned Jean had killed him. It seemed that Harlow and Gable could go on making movies together for decades and amass hit after hit. What a classic pair they were. Paul Byrne saw Harlow's potential as a smart, tough comedian when, at 21 and after almost 20 films, she was regarded as a has-been. He was producing Red-Headed Woman for MGM and fought to get Harlow for the lead. The film made her a star, and they were married shortly after it opened. Byrne was one of the only people who truly believed in Harlow as a serious actress and selflessly wanted her to succeed. It was a loving marriage, but sadly, it was doomed to an utterly heartbreaking end. No one understood what Jean Harlow saw in Paul Byrne. At 22, Harlow was one of the biggest film stars in the world. Her platinum blonde hair and salacious curves catapulted her to fame in the 1930 Howard Hughes classic, Hell's Angels. Around that time, Harlow met Byrne, a 40-year-old German film executive with MGM. Byrne was plain and serious, but he did have connections. He convinced MGM to sign Harlow, and, more importantly to Harlow, he believed she could be a serious actor, not just eye candy. After a short courtship, they married in July 1932. 2 months later, Byrne was dead of a self-inflicted gunshot wound to the head. Harlow's marriage to Byrne had been the talk of Hollywood, mainly because of the odd coupling it produced. Byrne, a native of Germany, was nearly twice the age of his 22-year-old bride, and was as mild-mannered and unassuming as his wife was fun-loving and uninhibited. He was short and balding, with an average appearance, while Harlow's hourglass figure, sparkling green eyes and gleaming smile, not to mention the pale blonde hair that had women across the country rushing to beauty salons for a similar look, accounted for much of her on-screen success. Still, what Byrne lacked in aesthetic appeal, he made up for with intelligence. He had a thriving career as a writer, director, and producer, and was so well known for his kindness and intellect that he earned the nickname Hollywood's Father Confessor, a marked contrast to his wife's blonde bombshell persona. Byrne and Harlow had been friends before they started dating, and Byrne had convinced MGM executives to purchase Harlow's contract from Hughes, a move that boosted her fame to even greater heights. The couple was engaged for only 2 days before their July 2nd wedding. Tinseltown gossips attributed the union to Byrne's desire to marry an attractive ingenue and Harlow's desire to use her husband's connections to advance her already thriving career. But Harlow's husband, MGM studio exec Paul Byrne, was dead in the bathroom, a bullet in his head. There was a gun in his hand and he was naked. His wife had spent the night with her mother. The body was found by a gardener. When Byrne's body was discovered by the household staff, the first call was not to the police, it was to MGM. The studio sent over its top fixers, who combed through the scene for 2 hours before police were summoned. In short order, police determined there was something strange about Byrne's personal history. The studio's story was that he had taken his life because of a personal problem he could not do anything about. His problem, it was put about, was impotence. The next day, the inner circle at MGM was given the official suicide because of shame story. At a coroner's inquest, Byrne's friends testified he'd long talked about suicide. Depression plagued his adult life, and the publicity since marrying one of Hollywood's hottest sirens seems to have taken its toll as well. MGM fixers hinted Byrne may have been biologically unfitted for marriage, a sordid rumour that cast blame away from Harlow and painted Byrne as weak and unworthy of the siren. He left her a suicide note she claimed not to understand. "Dearest dear," he had written, "unfortunately this is the only way to make good the frightful wrong I have done you and to wipe out my abject humiliation. I love you, Paul. You understand that last night was only a comedy." What did these statements mean? The embarrassment over his condition, made even more profound by his marriage to a beautiful starlet, had led him to end his life. Testimony from the butler supported this theory, as the butler indicated that though Byrne and Harlow had a loving marriage, Byrne had talked about killing himself. The assumption that arose from this testimony was that Byrne's alleged inability to have intercourse with his wife had plunged him into a depression from which he saw death as the only release. However, other evidence from the inquest contradicted this theory behind Byrne's death. The couple's gardener said he had never heard Byrne bring up the idea of suicide. The gardener also stated that Byrne and Harlow had a less than affectionate marriage, not the fairy tale relationship in which MGM and Harlow wanted the public to believe, and by extension, over which Byrne would have deemed it necessary to kill himself. In addition, Byrne's cook stated that on the night Byrne died, she had seen an unknown woman, not Harlow, on the grounds of the home, and that she had also found 2 empty glasses and a woman's bathing suit in a size other than Harlow's near the couple's pool. If the cook's testimony was to be believed, it would seem that Paul Byrne hadn't been alone on the night, and maybe even at the time of his demise. It seemed Harlow wasn't his only spouse. His first wife, the woman he was still married to, was Dorothy Millett. Byrne's brother told the press that Byrne's common-law wife, Dorothy Millett, a New York actress who had been in a coma for 10 years, was now recovered and coming to California. Her decomposed body was found in the Sacramento River 9 days after Byrne's death. Millet disappeared from the Delta King, the press had taken to calling her the ghost wife. Many speculated she had faked her death. Rumours started that a mystery woman was seen with Byrne the day before his suicide. Why would a man who had everything kill himself? They started asking questions and searching the records to put together the picture of what did happen to Paul Byrne. He was shot by Dorothy Millet, and she was the suicide. Byrne had never divorced Millet. In fact, he'd set up a trust fund for Millet. A lawyer in New York confirmed Byrne's secret marriage. He said he'd drawn up a will for Millet over a decade ago. While Byrne built up his career at MGM, he continued to support his wife back in New York. After her health recovered, she moved into the Algonquin Hotel. Byrne sent her a monthly stipend of $350, over $5,000 in today's money. They wrote each other often. Letters found in Millet's handbag at the Plaza Hotel were on MGM stationery. One of the letters was written a few months before Byrne and Harlow's wedding. In it, Byrne responded to Millet's plan to vacation in San Francisco. He recommended both the Plaza and Clift hotels and said he would fund her trip. "If you do go," Byrne wrote, "I hope that it will be a happy change." He signed it, "My love and best wishes always." At the inquest, Byrne's personal doctor, Howard P. Jones, said he knew exactly what was at the root of his friend's suicidal ideations. Out of respect for Byrne, Jones would not disclose it publicly, but, he assured, it had nothing to do with Dorothy Millet or any other woman. Harlow stayed incommunicado at her mother's and never had to face the police. The film she was making with Clark Gable, Red Dust, was shut down. While MGM went to work spinning the story to protect their star, police were seeking a paper trail. It had been feared that this scandal would be the end of Harlow's career, but she never said another word about it, and it did eventually fade into the background, another strange twist in her own short and eventful life. No one knows exactly what the studio brass did upon their arrival in the Byrne-Harlow home, but it's safe to assume they searched the premises for anything that could prove incriminating to the newly widowed Harlow. After reviewing the testimony, the inquest came back with an official cause of death, suicide. Yet, while the matter was settled in the books, not everyone believed that Paul Byrne had killed himself. A minority of skeptics believed that Harlow had killed Byrne and that MGM executives' visit to her home was an attempt to cover up the evidence of her crime. Producer Samuel Mark suggested that Byrne's first wife, Dorothy Millet, who had mental problems and leapt to her death from a ferry days later, had actually killed him, in his opinion. The truth, though we will never know for sure, is likely much more mundane, although just as tragic. To defuse the scandal surrounding Byrne's death, MGM arranged a quick marriage for Harlow to cinematographer Hal Rossen in 1933. The couple divorced 8 months later. In the ensuing years, Harlow's film career remained strong, but her health did not. She had struggled with medical issues throughout her life and fell seriously ill in 1937 during the filming of the movie Saratoga. Harlow died of kidney failure on June 7th of that year at the age of 26. To her dying day, she never spoke publicly about Paul Byrne's death. If you liked this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you are new here, and if you want to support my work, please visit my Patreon page. Now it is your turn. What do you think about the tragic story? Was Paul Byrne's death a sleazy suicide or masked murder?